now here in today case 1985-7084-CF. This is the State of Florida versus James Daly. My name is Pat Syracusa. This is a post-conviction conviction action on a first-degree murder conviction from 1987. There is no recording of this proceedings by phone from the audience. Please, everybody in the audience with phones, please turn them off at this point. James Daly is present and is here in custody. I've had him travel from death row for today's hearing. Good morning, Mr. Daly.
Good morning, sir.
There are numerous attorneys present representing each side in the proceedings, and I'm going to have everybody present slowly announce their names for the record, and as I always do, I'm going to start on my right or left. And when you announce your name, I also want you to announce the agency that you're affiliated with. Actually, before we start that, is there anybody that's appearing by phone today?
I believe yes, Your
Honor.
Who? One attorney sit off in the room, one of the front office today's attorney.
All right.
Do you need the phone number?
No, I've got it. I was hoping I wouldn't have to do it on this. That's fine. Carolyn, can you have somebody that knows how to work these phones come down and you help me with this phone in this courtroom, because I dialed the numbers I do in my courtroom and it doesn't work here. Are you? Welcome to the party. Come on. Get up on camera.
If you can do it from there.
Yeah. What am I missing? I'm not missing anything, just so we're clear on that. Nope.
Okay.
No worries. Well, I warned everybody that appear by phone wasn't an easy option in this courtroom, so I'm not appearing by phone yet. Okay, so beginning all the way on the end, let's begin the identifications.
Good morning, Your Honor. On behalf of Mr. Daly.
Good morning, Your Honor. Stephen Morgan, Millbank, LLP.
Good morning, Kara Otterbanger from CCRC on behalf of Mr. Daly.
Good morning, Your Honor. Laura Fernandez on behalf of Mr. Daly from Yale Law School.
Scott Edelman from Millbank, on behalf of Mr. Daly.
Your Honor, Josh Dubin, on behalf of my friend, Mr. Daly.
Glenn Martin, Office of the State Attorney.
Christy Osner, Office of the State Attorney.
Sarah Max from the State Attorney's Office.
Jim Hellickson, State Attorney's Office.
Timothy Freeland, Office of the Attorney General, State of Florida.
Second successive motion to vacate the judgment of conviction and sentence of death after the death warrant has been signed. Governor DeSantis originally signed the death warrant back on September 25th of 2019. The original execution was scheduled for November 7th, 2019. The federal stay was granted until December 30th, 2019. First issue, AG's office, have you heard anything from the governor's office that the execution date has been set or if there's any motion forward now that the stay has been lifted?
No, Your Honor.
No? Anybody from the state hear anything on that?
No, Your Honor.
No. Anybody from the defense?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. So, as far as I know, there's not an execution date set. Second issue today, I did an in-camera review of the documents provided by the state attorney's office that were requested by the defense at our last full hearing, I guess about 3 weeks ago. After a review of the documents, the court's not going to compel the disclosure of any further documents. I'm sure you expected that because you would have already received them if I had. Third issue before we get started, phone recordings. I ordered at least one or two calls between Mr. Pearcy and his mother disclosed from the DOC, as well as some email correspondence. I've had a chance to listen to the phone calls that were provided to me, and only because I think it'll help me get the measure of Mr. Pearcy when I have to talk to him in a few minutes. The defense was requesting some additional phone records. DOC objected. After having reviewed the phone records that you already got, do you still need these additional phone records?
Your Honor, I'm going to let Ms. Shirley handle the legal argument, but the answer is a resounding yes.
Okay.
Most respectfully, Your Honor, there are conversations between Mr. Pearcy and his mother that make it crystal clear on the two calls we received that she spoke to him right after news that Mr. Pearcy confessed to committing the murder of Shelley Baggio alone hit the newspapers on December 27th. In one of these two phone calls, he says to her, "You went wild. You were ranting and raving." And the ranting and raving phone calls happened in December.
Okay.
And we have been told by the Department of Corrections that there are 12 calls between December 27th and January 18th. They are highly probative. They go directly to whether or not and how this Simon, Mr. Pearcy's mother, in some way convinced him to now try to come in here and change his mind. We are entitled to those records. I'm going to let Ms. Shirley handle the legal argument as to why we're entitled.
Okay. Ms. Shirley, give me your legal argument.
Okay, yes, Your Honor. So, DFC objected for two reasons. The first, that our request was untimely because they said we should have requested it previously on February 25th. However, the information we had at that time did not allow us, we didn't know that call existed. So we went to see Mr. Pearcy on February 24th. He said in the last 3 days, from February 21st to the 24th, he received two calls from his mom in which they discussed his testimony. So we based our public records request on that information. Between the 21st and 24th, there were two calls which DOC turned over. Then, as Mr. Dubin said, on those two calls, they discussed a prior phone call where Mr. Pearcy described his mother as excited, as ranting and raving, as upset that he's going to come in here and testify that he's actually the one that murdered the victim in this case. So that's the phone call that we're seeking, but we didn't know that call existed until we listened to these two phone calls. So how are we supposed to know on February 25th to ask for something that I didn't know existed? Just a not credible argument. So their second argument, they again rely on the Bent case, which we had talked about on Tuesday, Your Honor, and they say that in Bent, which is a fourth DCA case, the site is 46 Southern 3rd, 1047, it's a 2010 case, and in that case, the court declined to release phone calls because they said the contents of the calls were not about a crime, a security risk, they weren't perpetuating or maintaining anything about the case. So that's what they rely on. So again, as I mentioned to Your Honor, the fourth DCA revisited this exact issue in Palm Beach newspapers these days, which is 183 Southern 3rd 480 in 2016. And in that case, we have a defendant, Mr. Smith, who's charged with first degree murder. We have an inmate that's going to testify against Mr. Smith, just like Mr. Pearcy. And the inmate makes a phone call in which he discusses his testimony, and the fourth DCA ordered those phone calls to be released. They said they are well within the realm of public records because, unlike the calls in Bent, which is the case DOC relies on, the calls here involve the witness's activities about which he intends to testify. This puts the calls within the realm of public records disclosure. So that's the case we're relying on. They distinguish it from Bent, which is the case DOC relied on. And Your Honor, the facts are much more similar to what we have here than the Bent case. And I do have a copy of the Palm Beach newspaper case if Your Honor would like it.
It's okay. No, you're all right. DOC, is there a DOC representative present today?
No,
not a surprise to them.
Yes, but they are in Tallahassee. They were notified of it a day before a hearing to be present. I think they were available by phone to be present at the hearing. And they did file an objection, so we do know that.
They did file an objection, yes. That's also how I know that they do have a hearing on it today. Well, 12 phone calls, 15 minutes each. So 3 hours worth of phone calls that you want me to give you this morning.
Your Honor, we're happy to proceed today. I don't want to be presumptuous, but I think that we are going to be in the territory of a cumulative hearing, regardless of what Mr. Pearcy does today. And I will present my legal arguments for that. So we are perfectly happy to proceed today. We're at an extreme disadvantage because we think that not only is there a reason why they're trying to not turn those over, we think that there is highly probative, some of the most relevant information as to why he may come and try to, in his words, play games with the proceeding today. So we're happy to take them up once we get them and review them, and when we come back for a cumulative hearing, we can do it then. Up to your honor.
Yeah, I'm going to reserve ruling on this one. I already gave you the first two phone calls pretty much without hesitation. I'll talk to you about whether it's necessary to give you the additional 12. I listened to the first two. I didn't hear anything that you suspected that was on it though.
Your Honor, I can point out to you,
yeah,
in those calls,
yeah,
where Jack Pearcy, may I approach?
Wherever you want to come.
Where Jack Pearcy says to his mother, "You were going crazy, I couldn't even calm you down." When she learned of the news,
right,
and that
you were going to contact this person and
that person, we have to know what it was she said to him. Did she say that? Did he say to her, "Well, Mom, I have to tell the truth now"? And she said, "Yeah, but if you do that, you have no opportunity to ever appeal this again." We have no idea what she said to him to try to convince him to come in here today and now change his story yet again. What's the harm here? We're talking about 12 phone calls. They have already turned over two. They couldn't be more relevant, quite respectfully, Your Honor. Couldn't be more relevant for a man that tries to wiggle out once he tells the truth under the penalty of perjury, signs an affidavit on one time. They did the same thing. His mother, everybody goes down there. So we think they're highly relevant.
Save it. Let's not spend all our outrage in the first 5 minutes. I don't know. I don't know where this is going to go yet today. So let's hang on. All right.
Sure.
All right. So, reserving on the third issue of the phone calls, that takes us to our fourth issue: defense motion to prevent witness interference. I read the defense's motion. I read the state's response. We've already kicked off the hearing today. We're 20 minutes into it. Does anything have anything meaningful to add on this before I rule on it? Defense, your motion, do you have anything meaningful to add? You didn't already write your motion?
Just briefly, Your Honor, for the record, if I may say.
Sure, everything's for the record. What do you want to tell me?
So, yes, Your Honor. So we filed this motion in order to protect the defendant's 6th and 14th Amendment rights.
Mm-hmm.
So the state's repeated interference with our witnesses, again, violates the 6th and 14th Amendments, which guarantee the defendant the right to a compulsory process for obtaining witnesses and the right to due process. So we get this from the landmark case of Webb v. Texas, as I mentioned earlier, before, which is 409 U.S. 95, 1972, where the U.S. Supreme Court found that the trial judge gave the witness a lengthy admonition about the dangers of testifying and perjury, and this interferes with the defendant's ability to get testimony out of the witness.
So you're telling the witness about perjury and stuff under perjury is a bad thing?
Not a bad thing, it's not per se error. That's not what I'm trying to say.
Right, but you're saying that mentioning perjury to the witness is something that could be intimidation?
I think most definitely, in the way it's been done in this case repeatedly by the state, from the fact that they tried to get Mr. Pearcy an attorney, to the fact that they have repeatedly tried to Mirandize him on the record, they tried to warn him of all the consequences to his federal cases, to his parole cases. And I think the most interesting thing, Your Honor, about the state's response is what they don't deny. There's a lot of sidestepping in it. I'm happy to continue, but we would rely
question. Why, when I read Mr. Pearcy's deposition on February 25th, do I find on page 59, line 8 through 13, page 95, line 2 through 9, and page 109, line 23 through 25, your attorney telling Mr. Pearcy about perjury and making false statements under oath? I mean, if it's so bad, why is it that your co-counsel is telling Mr. Pearcy about it?
We have no authority to bring perjury charges, Your Honor. It's really an threat. I mean, if the state says we're going to bring perjury charges, that carries much more weight than someone who has no authority to do anything.
All right, so you're allowed to do it, but they're not. I understand.
Yeah, I mean,
I was just checking, just because I had a feeling this was going to come up, and I've read that deposition four times now, and one of the things that jumped out is I never saw Mr. Martin use the words perjury, but I saw counsel for the defense use it in three different places. I know Mr. Martin Mirandized him effectively, or gave him the short version of Mirandize on page 5 is where Mr. Martin starts with the giving him his rights, talking to him about parole commission, and then penalty of perjury on page 7, line 4 through 8. But then as the deposition progresses and we get into the back half, that's when counsel for the defense starts mentioning it. I'm just trying to make sure that I understand. Is this a one-way street, or is this apply both sides?
Can you give those sites again, Your Honor, real quick?
Yeah, sure. Page 59, 95, and 109, it's you. And page 5 through 7 is Mr. Martin.
May I just interject, since you can ask the question for a moment?
Sure.
Okay.
It says what it says. If you want to talk to her, I mean,
I want to make sure that it's crystal clear for the record what it says and what the context is.
It's in the record. I mean, anybody can read the deposition. So it's lines 8 through 13 on page 59, lines 2 through 9 on page 95, and lines 23 through 25 on page 109.
The critical distinction, Your Honor.
Okay.
Right before I begin asking questions, what happens is that Mr. Martin, reason we asked for the recording, a loud voice
right.
starts telling Mr. And with all respect, Your Honor,
Mr. Pearcy about his rights.
Right. And he said, yeah. Do you understand you might, on page 7, lines 4 through 8, do you understand you might even be subject to the penalties of perjury
yep.
if there are inconsistent statements? Your Honor, he's made inconsistent statements for 20 some odd years. So that's the one point. When I ask him the questions, I am asking him, at page 59 and everywhere else, that when he signed an affidavit and when he signed a declaration, did he understand that